dreams come alive. Life is for living with you. I made my decision. You lift me up, fill my eyes with wonder. Forever young, your love is freedom's untainted. With you, the moment is wasted. Nothing like living with you. This life you created, I choose. See the sun. What living is it love? If it was, am I living it? Do I live in it? So astounding. Love is an ocean, you can drown it. A sweet embrace, the lovely taste I taste and see. The mundane grace, the place to be. It means I'll never need an umbrella. Cool in the cold in the hot weather, whether or never ever. Understand, I'm a man in the hands of great plans. I stand with faith and a life, but never known to touch. It's still outside my clutch, but I'm like, what's the dream of? What's the hope for? What's the doubt for? Get to know it. This is living. Life I've been living to gift. If I'm a living, I'm a living to death. So what's the dream of? What's the hope in? What's the doubt for? Live to know in. This is living. Life I've been living to gift. This is living now.
Just breathe and worship God and just feel free to dance and just express your love for him and whatever it looks like. Oh, Father God, we come before you now.
I stand before you now. The grace. Draw me out.
so much sweeter than anything I've tasted. I want to know your heart. I want to know your heart. I want to know your heart. We want to know your heart, God. Pull me a little closer. Take me a little deeper. I want to know your heart. I want to know your heart. Because your love is so much sweeter than anything I've tasted. I want to know. We welcome you this morning, God. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your prayer. Tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. My heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, yes, your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what. come here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Oh, your presence, Lord. All we need is your presence, God. Saturate us, Lord, with your presence, God. There's no place I'd rather be, Lord. Thank you.
sense in the presence of the Lord this morning that, you know, sometimes some things just happen because he's here. We used to sing a song that said, God is here, and the recognition of that meaning, if he's here, everything else is okay. You know, that we live by his presence. And the thing that separates from all the other people of the world, of the earth, and this is what Moses said to God, you know, your presence has to go with us because it's the only thing that makes us different, right? Because we all face difficulties. Same as the world, you know, you face the same difficulties the world faces. But the thing that makes us different is the presence of the Lord. And David, the psalmist David, he understood that. And he wrote a psalm where he said, I will bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. And all, everybody say all. You know what that means? It's very deep theologically. All means, that's deep. He said, all that is within me, bless his holy name. See, this morning, this isn't just about God touching us. It's about us touching God. And I will bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. And I don't know what you've got to let go, what part of your all you got to let go this morning, but let's let it all go today. Let's let it all go today. Hallelujah. I will bless the Lord.
I will bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord at all times. At all
times. That means right now, right here, in this moment.
I will bless the Lord.
I will bless you, Lord.
I will bless the Lord.
Yes.
At all times. At all times.
I will bless you, Lord. Your praise will be upon my lips. That's what he said. Hallelujah. Come on. If you haven't ever done it, would you just lift your hands? It just means I give up. I surrender. I give it all to you. I will bless the Lord.
I will bless the Lord. At all times. At all times. I will bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord.
Father, may you receive today the blessing of our heart. May you receive from us the love that we have for you in the midst of everything else we face and everything else that's going on around us. May we lose ourselves in you today. May we be changed by your presence today. That you have your way. And Lord, we lift it all to you. We give it, we throw, and we cast all our care upon you. All, everything, every burden that we carry over our families or our finances or our health or whatever it is, we release to you, oh God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is he okay? In Jesus' name, amen. He's okay, y'all. The devil is a liar. That makes me mad. The devil's a liar. This morning, the devil's a liar in your life. Amen? God wins. Turn to your neighbor and say, God wins. Amen? Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You good? Well, they're waiting. It's like when a player goes down on the field, everybody waits for him to get up, and then they, right? As soon as he gets up, I want you to shout to the Lord. Amen. The same way you do. See, here he comes. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I want you to greet somebody this morning. We're so glad to have you in the house of the Lord here at Epic Church. And God bless you. Find somebody you don't know and tell them you're glad they're here. Hallelujah. All these blue shirts you see around here are from the Dream Team here. And we had a Dream Team weekend. And it was an awesome time. And just as we gathered together to worship and hear the word of the Lord about the vision here at Epic Church. And so when you see us wearing these shirts, this is Dream Team Sunday. The Dream Team are those who serve all of us and help us make this happen every week. And it's an awesome thing. And if you're not a member of Dream Team, we want you to be. And you can find out at the information table with anyone if you want to connect and be a part of serving in this house. We'd love to have you do that. And there's a lot going on. So would you put your attention, please, to the screens?
Come be part of the team and let's make it happen here at Epic every Thursday evening. Child care will be provided from 6 to 8.
Good morning, Epic family. As the start of Epicenter Arts approaches on July 5th, we need your help. In order to provide this fourth year of service to the community free of charge, sponsors are needed to provide goods and or funds.
Yes.
Why do we not?
What's this?
The envelope?
I guess it's offering time. Oh my goodness. Amen. Good morning. You know, your being here is intentional and it's God's purpose.
Amen.
You know, I don't know how many of you have a job. Raise your hands. How many look forward to the weekend? Yeah, you do, don't you? For the right reasons. Now, we used to look forward so we could hang out all weekend and do what we want to do. But now we look forward to coming to the church with the people of God. But this past week, thinking about going on vacation and what I was going to be doing, like going to go see my grandchildren and help my one granddaughter drive because my son and them don't have the nerve to get in the car with her. You know, I got to thinking how grateful I am to serve such a great God. I mean, and it overwhelmed me. And I was, you know, I smile anyways. And I believe God's up to something. He gave me this smile. And so I use it a lot. And so when I smile, it's nothing new. But when somebody says something that I know, it's different than the last smile I made. And I couldn't help it, but I was focusing on the fact that, God, you're so good. I have no other reason but to smile. And I said, Lord, I look forward to serving you. And when I come to service, it's not a duty. It's a privilege. When I come to be with you all, I believe it's a foretaste of glory divine, that one day we're going to all be together and without no testimonies about how poor we are, how bad we're coming, it's coming, but it's going to be all the Lord in his glory. But until then, just be glad. Be grateful. You know, it's offering time. Yes, amen, amen. You know, when I was thinking about my offering, I was thinking how down through the years, it's been 41 years, and down through the years, God has done certain things in my heart to where now when it comes to offering time, I have to be careful to continue to give it the way I gave it the first time I gave it, you know? You can't get stingy because the world gets stingy. You can't go by CNN and decide how much you're going to give the Lord. It's just something that we do because it's the DNA of the kingdom of God. We are givers. We're givers by purpose. God has purpose for us to give. So I'm so grateful that my heart is settled on, Lord, you can have everything. You can have all. You know, it's still in my heart to give away a car. If he says give it away, you may not want it, but I'll give it. You know, it may be a little miles up there, but I'll give it because God said so. I'm so glad that he has that reign in my heart, that he can just say, Stanley, do this, and in God's grace, I do it. I just do it. Just so grateful. And I shared it earlier that I love him more today than I did the first day, 41 years ago, that he came into my heart. I love him more today. You know, there's a song that says, I love you more today than yesterday. but not as much as tomorrow. That's the way I feel about God. I can't wait for tomorrow because I know it's going to be that much more. Because I know he loved me. Even when I haven't wanted to be kept, he's kept me. And that's the same for all of us. As we get ready to give our offering this morning, we do so by giving our tithe first. So if you look in the back of the seats, you'll see that there's an envelope. That if you don't have one, that put your tithe in, and there's one, put your offering in. But we will do those separately. But I'd like to say this, that if you're here for the first time or the second time and you have a church home, don't bring your tithe here. They belong in your church home, okay? Your tithe, your offering, all right, you can do some of that, what you want. But do that for us because we want the blessing that God has for us, not for another place, okay? So this morning, I want you to get yourself ready. If you have your tithe, just come on down and give. Just your tithe. Praise God. Children are coming to give. Isn't that awesome? Let's give our children a hand in the Lord. Yes. Amen. We acknowledge that, Lord. They've come to give. A couple weeks ago, with the children came and they were supposed to put their offering in, and one of the helpers was holding a little girl, and she was smiling all the way down here as she was being held, and she had this envelope in her hand. And then as soon as she got over the basket, I think it was Kadisha, she said, "Let it go! Let it go!" And she was holding, "Let it go! Let it." I said, "You know, that's what we look like sometimes when we're supposed to be blessed by God. We don't know enough that God wants to bless us. We don't know how to let it go." And finally she let it go, and then she smiled back up the other side of the... But God showed me, said, "Stanley, that's how we are sometimes as adults. You know, we have a blessing God's waiting to give us, and we won't let what we have go so that we can get what he has for us because it's much bigger than we can hold in a hand. I'll say it again. What God has for you is much bigger than you can bring down here in your hand. And so give your seed so that God can give you a harvest. Is that all right? Praise God. It is offering time. It's time to give your offering. Let's praise God in the giving of your offering. Come on down. Praise him. Remember your attitude of praise. Bring glory and honor to God. Yes, Lord.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free.
Yes, Lord. I want to give you the mystery of the envelope. I asked for it for a personal reason. I just didn't give that reason, so they thought I wanted it for offering. But if you have an offering big enough to put in these envelopes, then come on down. Father God, we thank you this morning that we belong to you and you belong to us. We thank you, Father, that you cover us, Lord, that you go before us and you stand behind us. Lord, you are our rear and our front guard. Lord, you will keep us from falling and present us faultless in that great and terrible day. We thank you that we have the power to get wealth, and we give it, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We bring it for the kingdom's sake, Lord, and you multiply it. You make it work, Lord, and we will do what we can do because you will do what only you can do, and that you will multiply it and feed the multitude. We pray in Jesus' name. We want our barns filled, Lord. We want our storehouses filled in Jesus' name, and we do so in faith, believing that God will keep his word. Amen. Give the Lord a great big hand. Amen.
right. Awesome, 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 awesome. God is good. All the time, God is good. I'm so excited this morning. In our first service, I preached off a button. I'm telling you, I got to get tactical buttons or something, man, because I even sewed this one on, and I like wrapped it up like I did like a fishing lure, you know, and it was tight on there, and somehow I still preached it off this morning. So I'm just excited. That was an awesome hula worship dance, wasn't it? Man, that was spectacular. Does anybody not have a brown epic shirt? Who doesn't have one? Who doesn't have one? We got one in the front. If it's not your size, can you catch? If it's not your size, you can go trade it in for a size that is yours. Anybody else? Who doesn't have one? Oh, did I hit the light? You got it? Anybody else? Oh, in the back. Dear Lord. Oh, is it all the way? Is it all the way? Oh, that's a winner, winner. All right, here we go. Where? Where? Right behind. Let's see here. Anybody else? Anybody else? I'm going to go deep. I want to go deep. Woo. There we go. All right. Awesome. And those are for sale in the lobby, by the way. I got to do that with Dream Team with a bow and arrow. I didn't want to do that this morning. There's quite a few more people. It didn't work out so well yesterday in some cases, so I didn't want to do that. I want to talk to you this morning about being empowered. Whether we know it or not, we are born with a dependency and an addictive tendency in life in general. We are born to be addicted to something. We are born to be dependent upon something. And what happens in our life is because we are first born into sin until we accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, we look for various ways to empower ourselves to do that. Because unlike the disciples had Jesus. So they kind of just walked around with Jesus and they could do miracles as long as Jesus was around, as long as he was telling them what to do and how to do it, kind of releasing them here and there, letting them do some things. But we didn't have that. We didn't have Jesus just standing around, walking around with us, saying, okay, here's what you need to do, pointing this out and doing all kinds of stuff. We had that example literally in front of us, physically in front of us, like the disciples did. So we're born into sin, a slave to sin, as a matter of fact. And so I had this vision where we're born with a power outlet on us. We got this little outlet stuck on us that we're born into. We're a slave to sin. We are born with addictive, dependent tendencies inside of us. So it has to be met. We have to find a way to empower ourselves. We have to find a way to find joy. We have to find a way to find strength. Wow, this is just tucking all up. Before it went down my pant leg, but now it's just not. Anyway, so we're born with this outlet on us. And so we've got to find a way to be empowered. We've just got to be empowered. We got to plug ourselves into something somehow, some way. And so before we're Christians, before we accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, we'll get addicted to almost anything that'll bring us any form of temporal pleasure. So what we do is we go over here, and usually it's money first. You know, we find we got a little bit of money, and we get over here, and we get plugged in. Sorry. And we plug in, but, you know, I can only go so far. Money only goes so far, and I don't know if anybody else can say this, but sometimes I've got a little bit more month at the end of my money. Can anybody say that? Yeah, I know. Y'all know what I'm talking about. So we find ourselves going after money, finding that way to empower ourselves for joy, empower ourselves for strength, empower ourselves for purpose, and we plug ourselves, and we find we can't get as far as what we thought, or it doesn't last as long as what we thought, and we say, okay, we got to try something else. And so, you know, with our addictive tendency, sometimes that we find ourselves down that dark path of drugs and alcohol and substance abuse and things like that, and we go in and we try to find a high and perpetuate that high in our life to escape some of the hardships, some of the pain, just get out or get the high so we can just have the adrenaline rush all the time. And again, we find ourselves that's connected to a limitation. I can only get so far out. I can only get just so far into where I'm supposed to be, into that level of empowerment that I'm really looking for, that I was born to have. And so we go over, you know, somewhere else, and maybe we just go clubbing, or maybe we find ourselves going to parties or things like that. So we go over here, and we start looking, and we find some plugs over here, and we start plugging those in. There we go. And it brings us pleasure for a little while. We enjoy it for a little bit. We're just walking around with outlets on us, just plugging stuff in, trying to make ourselves feel better, trying to empower ourselves. And, you know, what happens is then we get saved. Now, sometimes, maybe even a lot of times in our Christian walk, none of the rest of these things change for us just because we're still walking in substance abuse. We're still chasing after money. But there is one major difference that when we accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, we start looking at outlets like church. So we'll go from one church to the next like we're swinging on a branch or something. We'll find this church and we'll get, oh yeah, we're going to get plugged in. No, no. Oh, yeah, I'm not going to do this. We're not going to that church anymore. So we'll go somewhere else. And now, of course, we're not relying on the Holy Spirit. We're not being called somewhere. We're not being sent somewhere. We're just trying to find that level of empowerment that we're looking for. And we get plugged in and we're like, oh, no, I'm not going here. Or we'll go there for a little while. We'll hide out till somebody says something that upsets us or offends us. Instead of working it through with them and doing the process of life, it's like, nope. I'm not doing that. I'm going to see what's over here on the other side right here. And, you know, maybe we even find ourselves doing a little church rotation. So we get a couple of plugs going on. Maybe a Sunday church here and a Wednesday because they have a better Wednesday program somewhere else. Or, you know, we find ourselves plugging in. And then they're telling me how I'm going to live at my house. They can't tell me what I'm going to do at home. They can't tell me what I can and cannot do. And what's this spiritual authority thing? I can't do that. And again, we find ourselves limited in our empowerment. It only feels good for a little while, not relying on the Holy Spirit. So we must begin to move into that place of empowerment. We are empowered by the Holy Spirit. We are empowered to do the things that God has called us to do. So we find ourselves today in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. In the Amplified, it says, in conclusion. Now, he's just summing it all up for us. Now, that's a meaty chapter there. It's a meaty letter that he wrote to the church at Ephesus. But in conclusion, let me sum it up for you. Be strong in the Lord. Be empowered through your union with him. Draw your strength from him, that strength which his boundless might provides. We have to find ourselves moving into a place where we are strong in the Lord. Not strong in the things of this earth, not strong in the things of this world, not strong in the things that we found ourselves being addicted to or dependent upon, but strong and dependent and addicted to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, so he can be the one that empowers us. So in the process of empowerment, we must first leave things behind and let things go. The disciples found this out the hard way. Jesus tells them right here in John chapter 16 in verse 5, but now I go away to him who sent me, and none of you ask me where you're going, because they didn't care. They were worried about the one that was showing them miracles was leaving them. And it says, but because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. We have a helper as a result of the disciples being able to let Jesus go and not let the sorrow fill their hearts so much so that they couldn't let Jesus go through the process that he was created for and put on this earth for, going through the process of dying on the cross, that we would have ultimate redemption and letting him go and letting him leave so that they could receive a greater blessing, which is the helper. So many times in our lives, we refuse to let the things go that we think are important. Sometimes we just have to let our money go. Sometimes we just have to let the addiction go, because the empowerment that comes from on high is so much greater, so much better, so much more impactful, so much more fulfilling than any other thing. If we took all these plugs and plugged them in, they wouldn't even come close to the empowerment that comes for the power and presence of God in our lives. We have to let them go. I remember I got a pretty hefty check from a project that I was working on, and after all the employees were paid and all the costs for materials and everything were deducted out, God said, just sign it on over. I was like, Jesus, I've already assigned this money. It's spent before it was made. And he was like, because he's silent, you know, because it's like, and? So I'm like, but Jesus, I already found ways and written up how to worship you in the process of distributing the funds of this, you know, blessing that you put upon us, and how to give servant, how to give your servant rest by dispersing some of these funds in a certain way, and then providing a rest for your servant so he can be rejuvenated to do the will of the Father. Yeah, you're going to have to sign it all over. I'm like, okay, Jesus, here we go. And I'm giving it, and I am letting it go. And it pains me, but the joy unspeakable and full of glory that comes as a result of the obedience and our aligning ourselves with the will and purpose and plan of the Father is greater than anything that I could have ever done with that money. Amen. Ever. And so when we find ourselves in our created dependent nature, being dependent upon the things of this world, we've got to let them go. Yes. We've got to cut them off. When we move into that place where we've had the revelation and understanding that the addictions of this world, that the dependencies of this world are temporary and they are just feelings that don't last very long, and they keep us tied down and they keep us from moving into the place where God has called us, we must then move into the place to where we said, I do want to be empowered by the Lord, that I have tried everything, or simply I believe the testimonies of others. Sometimes that's enough for some people, that they can just hear what somebody else had to go through and they're like, I don't want to go through that, so what can I do? And there are some of us that are like, yeah, whatever, and then we have to walk through it. And Pastor Shirley has said, God will take you the easiest way you will go. And I'm just like, Lord, I want to go easy this time, because I know what it is to take the hard road. Can you please, please show me the easy way? And it's like, I can't see it. It's like, I know it's here. It's like, where is the easy way? And that's just like, no, no. I just walk around that mountain a couple of times, you know. Get it. Anyway, so we find ourselves in a place to where we have the revelation that God wants to empower us. We have had the revelation that the things of this world are limiting and temporary, and we need an empowerment. It's not fulfilling us. We haven't found the place. We move into that place, and what do we do? How do we get empowered? By the presence of the Most High God. And we must have the revelation, and that we must be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Romans 12:12 says, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. We must transform ourselves by the renewing of our mind. We must brainwash ourselves through prayer, through fasting, through fellowship, through relationship, through church, through reading of God's word, so much so that we're renewing our mind, that it eventually it transforms the way we think, transforms the way we act, transforms the way we look at life and look at what God has called us to do, and transforms the way we look at the world and what it has to offer. It says, be not conformed to this world. We were born into this world, born a slave to sin, and we find ourselves being conformed to the world because it looks good. And it says in there's a way that seems right unto a man, but the end thereof is death. And we look at it, and I can't think of a better idea. You know, it looks good. The plans and plots of this world, it would be easy to conform to. I know exactly what to do. I know how to fit into that. I know how to mainstream myself into the program and the process that's set in front. But that's not what God is saying. God's saying, I need you to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Be not conformed to this world and its way of thinking and its way of doing things. This world says the more money you make, the better off you are. This world says the status that you have, the better off that you are. This world says the more things that you can accumulate determines how wealthy you are and how blessed you are and how happy you should be. Surprising statistic says that the happiest cities in America are the ones with the highest suicide rates. And the most depressed cities, which St. Petersburg is in the top five of most depressed cities in the United States, has the lowest rate of suicide. So it's not going to make you happy. Conforming to this world, finding the things that man has said is good and seems right will eventually lead to death. That's loud and clear. We must find ourselves being transformed by renewing our mind and saying over ourselves what God says over us, that you are blessed and that you are highly favored, that you're blessed going in and that you're blessed going out, and that you find yourself whether to the left or to the right, that you're still blessed and that you're still empowered and that God still loves you. And that there's nothing that anyone can do to pluck you out of his hands, that he is always for you, and that he is never against you. And no matter what, you can't find yourselves limited to the things that were. You find yourself being transformed. Usually evangelists have some of the greatest stories. It seems that they had the roughest time growing up and would do some of the most challenging things in the world. And they would always have that mama that would go out into the backyard, into some outhouse or carport or whatever it was back there, and kneel down and have this prayer time. And they'd pray out loud for all the neighbors to hear. And I mean, because back then you kept your windows open and stuff like that. They didn't have air conditioning, and most everybody didn't have TVs, and they just heard so-and-so praying down the shore. That's so-and-so praying. And they're just praying, and they would pray that their sons and daughters, that they would go out and try things of this world and it wouldn't work, that alcohol wouldn't get them drunk and the smoke wouldn't get them high. And sure enough, they'd go out into the world and they'd drink all night long and not get drunk. They'd smoke everything trying to get high and they couldn't get high. And they'd come home and say, Mama, what did you do? He was transformed. We move into that place where we renew our mind. We are so transformed that when we plug ourselves into the old things, they have no effect on us any longer. They can't make us high like they made us high before. They can't empower us the way they empowered us before. And in some way, it kind of feels gross and disgusting and uncomfortable. It's like, I don't even want to be a part of that anymore. I've just been so transformed. My mind's been so renewed. I've been able to go through and pray and get in fellowship and get into accountability to a place that I've been so transformed that I find none of this of value. None of this does anything for me anymore. I've got to be empowered, move into that place where we are transformed by the renewing of our mind. The next thing is we must realize that as we've accepted Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, that we are new creations. We are not what we were.
Amen.
What did is not what will be.
Right.
What we used to have is not going to work for our future anymore because we are new creations created in Christ Jesus. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. All things have become new. There is a revelation now that I can be truly dependent and addicted to the Most High God. And that is the only addiction that will fill the void that I was born with. We were born with a void that has to be filled. We have to do something to fill it. And we start in this world trying to fulfill it. And then we find Christ. And he has got up inside of us. And I want to thank God for a wireless God. I don't have to have this anymore because I've been transformed into a place to where I have a wireless God. I'm not limited to the things and the length that that can take me and how far these temporary emotions and feelings and highs can take me. I am ever connected to an ever-flowing, everlasting source all the time, ever strengthening me, ever empowering me to accomplish the will that I was created before I was formed in my mother's womb. Yes. We find ourselves being empowered because we have the revelation that we are new creatures and all things are new. We cannot go back to the past. There's a song that says there's nothing to go back to. There's nothing to go back to because once we've tasted of the sweet presence and manifested presence of the Most High God, I trust you, you will never turn back. It is greater than any drug that has ever been created or ever will be created. It's greater than any feeling that has ever existed. That's why Paul could stand so confidently and say, whether height nor depth, I have learned, whether abased or abound, I have learned to be content, because it didn't matter, because his empowerment came from the inside. So it didn't matter if he was in prison or if he was walking in the lap of luxury. It didn't matter to him because he was empowered. The external circumstances never determined the inward glow, the inward empowerment, because he knew that he could overcome any situation that he was faced because he had an everlasting source, an everlasting empowerment inside of him. Do what you will. It doesn't matter because you can't hurt in here. I have the everlasting, most high, powerful God inside of me who knows all, sees all, and does all, and with one blow can shake down a jail cell. With one blow can part the Red Sea. He'll do it, and he'll do it, and he'll do it, and he'll do it over and over again, because that's what you need, and that's where he's going to walk you through. He's going to make sure that you walk across on dry land. So now we find ourselves in the place of empowerment where we've accepted Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. We have renewed our minds. We've walked in that place of transformation, and we have realized that we are empowered, and we're like, what do I do now? It's like our whole life, like, I want $1 million, give me $1 million. You know, we win $1 million. It's like, what do we do with it now? Right. I don't know what happens. They have this documentary on what happens to lottery winners. And like all of them are like bankrupt in 5 years. Because they don't know what to do with it. It's like, you've got empowered. Now what do you want to do? Well, the scriptures have a great guideline of what we have been empowered to do. First, we have been empowered to put on the whole armor of God so that we can stand. Ephesians 6:11 says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. You have been empowered to stand and not fall down. That you can put on that armor and the enemy can throw his best shot, his best blows at you and try to knock you down and try to take you out, and you can have been empowered to stand. No matter what he does, no matter how he comes against you, no matter how hard he hits you, no matter how many times and what directions he comes against you, you have been empowered to stand against the enemy, and there is nothing that he can do to push you over. We've also been empowered to wrestle against the enemy. If the following Ephesians 6, going in verse 12 and 13, it says, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but we do wrestle against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, having done all to stand. So not only have we the armor of God and been empowered to stand and not fall, and the enemy can't knock us down, but we've been empowered to launch and declare war against the enemy and wrestle with him. So hey, I don't have to just stand here and turn the other cheek for the enemy. I can wage war against the enemy. I can wrestle. I've been empowered to wrestle. I tell you, a couple of weeks ago, we were praying for somebody in here. I was just so mad at how the devil had clamped up their mind. I had tears in my face. I was just so upset about it. And I was like, I wish right now that the devil could just manifest himself right now and I could throw him some gloves and we could square off a couple of rounds. Because I'd teach him some lessons. Yes, sir. I'd show him what I'm made of today. Because I was hot. I was hot because I cannot believe the devil, but I can stand there and I've been empowered to wrestle against the enemy. And he can try to take people's minds and he can try to take their souls, but I can wage war against the enemy and say, not today, not on my watch. I would not have you do anything to the children and the family of God. You've been empowered to be witnesses. It says Acts 1:8, but you shall receive power when the Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and as the ends of the earth. You have been empowered to be a witness. Your testimony is your witness of the great and mighty power of God. There was a place where you had to have dependencies and you had to have addictions of this world, but your mind has been renewed so that you've been transformed by in a place that you have walked out of that and aligned yourself with the empowerment of the Holy Spirit in the presence of God so that you can say to them, that doesn't work. This does. Or when they come to you, say, what is it that you've got? Well, let me just tell you, you've been empowered to be a witness. You've been empowered to share your testimony. You've been empowered to break the ice to the cubicle to your left or to the line in your grocery store or to the person that you've ordered from in the drive-thru. You've been empowered to be a witness to them that there is nothing that they can do to you. They're not going to reach across there and strangle you or beat you or anything because you've been empowered to be a witness of the Most High God, and they have to listen. You've been empowered to be a witness of how great our God is, how awesome He is, and how loving He is. You've been empowered to be free. Hallelujah. John 8:36 says, therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. The Son has made you free. You are have been empowered to be free from cables and cords and addictions of this world and confirmations of this world that bring you down and hold you back and weigh you down and keep you from accomplishing the will of the Father. You have been set free to stand up, stick your chest out, stick your chin up and say, I can do it, 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 I think I can, I think I can, I think I can, I think I can, I think I can. You have been empowered to be free by the power of the Most High God. You are free. You are free indeed. You are free to do everything that God has called you to be. You are not bound up and locked down. Poor me, I can't do it, but you are free. The chains of bondage have been broken off of your hands and feet and off of your mind and off of your spirit, and you have been empowered to be free in the presence of the Almighty God, doing everything that He has called you to be. Yes. Lastly, hallelujah, I'm so excited about this one because I know what's coming. You don't yet. Some of you do. You've been empowered to win. You have been empowered to win. It is one thing to play the game. It is one thing to participate in the race. It is a completely different thing to win. It is one thing to go through challenges and obstacles and hardships. It is another thing to win over your obstacles, challenges, and your hardship. It is one thing to walk through the processes of this life and the pain and the sacrifice as well as the joy, and it is another thing to win. You have been empowered to win. You are winners, not losers. You are the head and not the tail. Sometimes the easiest things and the things we're told the most often is what we forget the most. You are winners. You are a winner. Do you know what that means? It means you win. It's like when you're playing chess or checkers or running a race and you break it first. You are the winner. You are the one who gets the gold. You stand at the top of the steps. You win. You have accomplished and overcome your journey, your path, your obstacles. You win against the enemy. You win against his challenges. You win against the temptation of sin. You win when sin comes knocking on your door. You win over every situation you find yourself in. You are a winner. Romans 8:37 says, yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. How are we more than conquerors? Because our great king sent his son down to die on the cross for us. And in that moment, he became the conqueror. And as participants and as accepting Jesus Christ as our personal savior, we have become more than conquerors because we have accepted that redemptive power and empowerment into our lives to move into a place where he is already defeated. Because I'm a winner, baby. I'm a winner. Winner, winner, chicken dinner. Whatever you want to say, I'm a winner. So we need to declare that we are winners today. We need to walk out and roll our windows down and say, I'm a winner. I find myself in situations all the time, and I'm like, oh, Lord, I don't know how I'm going to get out of this one. And in my job that I do, I'm doing some broadcast stuff, and I've got this manufacturer on the phone and this manufacturer on this phone because these two components are not talking together. I've got the client here who's just chewing all their fingernails, worried that their system's not going to function because their supervisor's not going to do this, and you know they're going to lose their job or whatever. So I'm just here, and we're working, and we're tweaking. I'm doing this and writing code and changing this and plugging it in here and rerouting this and doing it. And then all of a sudden it works. And I'm like, and I stand up and I say it. I say, because I'm a winner, baby. I say it all the time. I say, because I'm a winner, I'm a winner. And I tell you, sometimes I walk in and I can tell my atmosphere is not right. And I can tell what I'm walking into, that building, that place that I'm at, or that workplace. Or it's sometimes just driving down the road, I can tell that my attitude's climbing up. And I just mumble it right under my breath. And I'll come into a place going, I'm a winner, 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 I'm a winner. I'm a winner, I'm a winner, I'm a winner. And don't, I'm not kidding, y'all. I am mumbling under my breath, and people are looking at me going, what were you saying? And I tell them, I was saying that I'm a winner. Because I'm a winner. You're a winner. You can't lose. And we just sit and we hear this mighty roar of the enemy, and it sounds like these ground troops are just earth shaking around us, and the ground's shaking because the enemy's just so strong and so vicious. And then we just move the curtain and we see a little bitty chihuahua there. It's all bark, baby. Because I'm a winner. There's nothing he can do. I've been empowered to stand. I've been empowered to overcome. I've been empowered to be free. I've been empowered to be more than a conqueror. I've been empowered to be a blessing. I've been empowered to be blessed. I've been empowered to prosper. I've been empowered to be healed. When we find ourselves in that place where we must declare over our lives that we are a winner, roll down your window and yell it out. Go, if you need to do it in the drive-thru, wherever it is, when the enemy comes against you and you think, because what he wants us to do is he wants us to think we're this. Oh, I just can't do it. It's so hard for me. I just can't do it. That's what he wants us to see. And so he shows us this distorted image of ourselves. We're all like laid down and beat up and bruised and tired and losing and all of this stuff. And no, we've got the armor of God. We're standing. We just need to move ourselves aside to where we're transforming ourselves by the renewing of our mind and see ourselves as God sees us. And he sees us as winners. He sees us as more than conquerors. And when you begin to see yourself in the light that God sees you, there is nothing that the enemy can say or do that will halter your path. He can try to come against you with fear, doubt, and disbelief, but you're not going to do it. You're going to stand firm, stand strong, and declare that I'm a winner, baby. I'm a winner. 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 Somebody say it this morning. I'm a winner. Declare it over your life right now. I'm a winner. I'm a winner. Declare it over your household right now. I'm a winner. I'm a winner. I'm a winner. I'm a winner. Declare it over your workplace right now. I'm a winner. I'm a winner. I'm a winner. I'm aware. Declare it over the situation and circumstances you think you're losing right now. I'm a winner. I'm a winner. I'm a winner. I'm a winner. God is good. God is good because I'm a winner. 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 We just need to look at the mirror and tell ourselves that we are a winner. When the things of this world approach us in our face and would tempt us to walk away and empower ourselves through another means by the presence and power of God, we need to say, no, because I'm a winner. No, because I've overcome. No, because I've been empowered to be free. I'm a winner. 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 I can't say it enough. We need to say it until we've transformed our mind to the place where we understand that I'm a winner and that there is nothing that the enemy can do. And he's all bark, baby. Yeah. Because I'm a winner. I'm a winner. Stand to your feet with me this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm a winner, I'm a winner, I'm a winner. We are winners, we are winners, we are winners. We have been empowered to win. We have been empowered to conquer. We've been empowered to be free. We've been empowered to be witnesses. We've been empowered to change our situations and circumstances. We've been empowered to change the situations and circumstances of those that are around us as well. There is no place we are not allowed to go because God's already won it. He's already won it. We move into that place, moving into a place that we are more than conquerors. Lift your hands with me. Father, right now, I just declare that we are winners today. Father, that a revelation would set inside of us that we have not had before, that our minds would be transformed to the place that we would no longer see ourselves as the enemy sees us as losers and down and out and hurt, but that a spirit would rise up inside of us that recognizes and reveals to us that we are empowered by the mighty presence and power of the Most High God, that we are empowered to be free, that we are empowered to be winners, and that we are winners in every aspect of our life. As we follow your will and plan and purpose for our life, we are winners, God. Father, let that set in our spirit. Brand that in our minds, Lord, that we are winners. Let us walk out of here knowing that we are winners and declare it in our everyday life. In the name of Jesus, we pray. As a family, I want us to understand that, you know, around this world, there are perils and things that are going on. And right now in Ohio, there is a flood where they have started to evacuate cities and people are in danger of losing everything that they have as a result of that. And this morning, when that was brought to my attention, I felt like what we needed to do is do like Moses and hold our hands over the water right now and just tell the waters to recede right now. Would you pray with me? Father, right now, we pray over Ohio right now and we say, peace be still. We say right now that the waters would recede and go back, and that there would be a Holy Ghost dam built to protect the people of that city, that there would be nothing lost that the enemy could not take away, and that the enemy would not triumph, but that through this you would get the glory. That even right now the tides are turning and water is beginning to recede at our words, because we believe there is no distance in prayer, and that right now your Holy Spirit is now protecting and building a wall to protect that city from these great floods right now, and that not one of them would have any loss. In the name of Jesus, we declare it and say that it is so. And everyone who agrees with that, say amen. Amen. Hallelujah. God is good. Go out and be empowered this week to change somebody's life and just declare over your life that you are a winner. Amen. This area down here is open and up front. If you'd like prayer for anything, we'd love to come into agreement with you. Have a great week. Love you guys. Amen.